Hello, everyone, and welcome into CrushTheStreet.com. Thanks for tuning in today. I am Kenneth Amanduri, and I'm joined today with Bryan Slusarchuk, and he's the president and director of K92 Mining. And he's an international business person, experienced in funding companies, involved in mineral exploration, development, and production. And K92 is a company on its way to being a mid-tier producer, and they've hit the ground running here. They're traded on the TSXV under KNT, and on the US side under KNTNF. And today we're going to be talking to an expert in the mining industry about the current financial situation of the global economic mess. And Bryan Slusarchuk, thanks for joining me.
Kenneth, thanks a lot for having me on.
Bryan, you know what? As I said, you got a lot of insight in the economy and just in the mining sector. And two things that are closely related and right now, especially in an environment of fear, is gold. So I want to get your insight on this. You know, I'm looking at Deutsche Bank now. Last I checked, it was below $13, and it was looking like they are going to have a Bear Stearns or Lehman-type moment in the near future here. This global mess is getting pretty serious here. Would you agree with that?
Yes, absolutely, Kenneth. And I think that the important thing to realize here is that we're staring down the possibility of multiple Bear Stearns or Lehman-type collapses out there. A lot of people that are following the gold market from afar, who are generalists, are pointing to this Brexit event as being a real catalyst for the gold price movement. However, as guys like you know, Brexit came about as gold had already established a long-term, the start of a long-term trend. The bullish uptrend was in place when Brexit occurred. Brexit was a momentary event that will have, no doubt, long-lasting and lingering consequences. But it spurred gold higher in a small way, but the bigger picture is much, much larger than that. We've got a system that's just not working, and when this system collapses to some degree, we're going to see something that just doesn't end well. We've got central bankers across the world trying to prop up each other's fiat currencies with more worthless fiat currencies. There's no true store of value behind a lot of this paper that's getting printed. And sure, we've got low to a negative real interest rate environment. We've got people that believe the U.S. dollar may have peaked against other global currencies. There are ongoing macro risks, but above and beyond all of that, we've got a monetary and fiscal policy or set of policies worldwide via the central bankers that just doesn't work. And that is going to lead to some sort of collapse. And even people that aren't traditionally big gold bugs are seeing the need to own gold right now. Just in the past few days, I think you may have seen BlackRock's head of asset allocation worldwide state that gold is poised to go much higher. And he states about the macro environment that in this type of volatility, you need some hedge, and there are very few hedges that work as reliably as gold. So we're starting to see even the non-believers in gold up to this point start to look at their portfolios with real worry and concern and point out the fact that if you don't have some exposure to gold, you better at least have some exposure as a hedge.
Mm. Yeah, no, it's very true. And a lot of big key people are coming out and saying that very thing. I mean, we got Ray Dalio, George Soros, Carl Icahn, and just a number of people that are worried about the stock market and getting into gold. So Bryan, I want to talk about, you know, what we're facing here in 2016 and maybe get your thoughts on 2008, you know, as a comparison. Is what we're seeing different than what we dealt with in 2008? Or would you say it's going to be worse? And I might also add that, you know, during the 2008 financial crisis, we did see metals get slammed down along with everything else. So kind of your thoughts on that.
Sure. I think that in many ways, we're in a more precarious situation now than we were in 2008. And the reason that I say that is, what have we done since 2008? Well, what we've done is we've seen governments and central banks, in their wisdom, print more money, and then print more money, and then print more money. At the same time, run up huge deficits, trying to stimulate the economy through a combination of extremely loose fiscal policy and extremely loose monetary policy. And now, what bullets are left? We have a low or even negative interest rate environment in most parts of the world. What bullets are left? We already have spent huge amounts of capital trying to fiscally stimulate the economy through direct government intervention. What bullets are left? And in 2008, we had financial companies that went into crisis mode, and you mentioned Bear Stearns, you mentioned Lehman, and the governments were able to come in with quantitative easing infinity, I call it. I don't call it QE1, QE2, QE3, etc. It's become QE infinity. They were able to come in and at least postpone a dire, dire situation. But what has that led to? It's led to a state where globally we're in as much trouble as we've ever been in, and the ammunition that the central bankers had and that the central government had is just not there. And when you see things like Brexit occurring, that's not a final outcome. That's the start of something. That's the start of people starting to challenge the status quo. There are people out there right now moving, I think, quite wisely around the world into gold and precious metals as a hedge, because I think what you're seeing is the gradual loss of faith in the central bankers to continue this charade of never-ending fiscal and monetary quantitative easing and stimulus.
Mm. Bryan, talking about the markets and gold, the stock market is, you know, we're kind of on the verge of hitting new highs here, potentially, with the Dow, the S&P. And you know what, one of the things you've talked about, I've heard you in other interviews talk about the Dow to gold ratio. And back in history, in 1980, it was around 1-to-1. In 1934, 1 ounce of gold bought you the Dow Jones. And, you know, in that aspect, what do you suppose is going to happen to the Dow Jones and gold here with the Dow to gold ratio?
You know, that's a very interesting ratio. And one of the guys, Kenneth, that seems to always point that out is Pierre Lassonde. And, of course, you know Pierre Lassonde, as many of your listeners will also know. Pierre Lassonde is a legendary gold investor and has, more times than not, called it right in his career. And one of the reasons he's become one of the most successful investors in gold in the world is because he's been right so often. And he talks about the Dow to gold ratio, as you've mentioned, and talks about the Dow here at 17, 18,000, and states openly with a question, well, will it get there? And then supports the argument as to why the Dow and the gold number should equate. But as he comments, even if it gets halfway there, we're talking $8,000, $9,000 an ounce gold. Mm. Where do I think it will meet? that's the tough question, because I have a whole lot of concern for people that are heavily invested in the Dow stocks. I think that there are arguments to be made as to that U.S. stock market being, in general, overvalued. Will it come down to where gold is at today? I don't think it will come down to 1,300. Do I think gold's going to 19,000? Well, perhaps. You've heard Jim Rickards talk about $10,000 gold, $20,000 gold. But my guess is it'll be somewhere in the middle. And I think, therefore, based on that ratio alone, and there are a number of other arguments to support this, that gold has a real chance to trade $5,000, $6,000, $7,000. Now, with that being said, I still think that the lessons of the last bear market in gold have taught us that we still need to look for high-grade gold projects that work, even if the gold price stays irrationally low for a longer period of time than we believe it will. Do I think gold will get to $5,000 or $6,000 an ounce? Yes, I personally do. But I also want to personally be invested in companies that still can work really, really well and operate really, really profitably if gold is $1,100, $1,200, $1,300. Because at times, as you know, there can be irrational pricing in the market for periods longer than some retail investors can stay solvent. So I think that even though gold's going higher, you still want to be cautious by investing in high-grade projects with size and without a lot of CapEx risk.
Bryan, that leads me right into the next thing that I want to talk to you about. And, you know, a lot of people have been scared out of the markets over the last few years. It's been a really brutal bear market. And K92 managed to do something that was very unique. And it was a very aggressive move, purchasing a mine that Barrick invested $140 million in. Purchased for $140 million and invested another $100 million, $250 million into this mine, making it turnkey. And K92 picks it up for $2 million during the trenches of the bear market. So, you know, talk to us about this story here, because, you know what, maybe a lot of other companies weren't able to be as fortunate as you, and I know that's the case. So, share this and expand on this a little more for us.
Sure. And this is sometimes, or more accurately, quite typically what we see when we see a prolonged depressed period in gold. And for 5 years, the gold equities really suffered. Barrick Gold, for example, when they sold us this asset, had $13 billion. That's $13 billion U.S. dollars in debt. They had a mandate, and they stated it publicly, that they would start to divest of all non-core assets. They would get out of Southeast Asia, Australasia completely, and divest of their holdings there. Now, at that time, there weren't a lot of guys looking for gold assets. Nobody, in fact, seemed to want to be in the gold space. We, fortuitously, had built a team that really wanted to go out and find gold assets. We were bullish on the long-term prospects for gold. And we also knew, with the team that had been put together, guys like Ian Stocker. Ian was the CEO of Euromint. It started off as a micro-cap with a tiny market capitalization. And less than 3 years later, Ian, as CEO, sold Euromint for $2.5 billion U.S. Tookie Angus, who was one of the founding directors of Ventana Gold, that sold for $1.3 billion in the last gold bull market. Tookie's also the chair of Nevsun. A real class team of guys. We knew that we would be able to finance, in the tough times, privately, the advancement of a gold project if we found one of merit. Well, what we were able to find is an asset that, as you mentioned, Barrick had purchased for $141 million U.S., subsequently put substantial capital into it, advancing it, and by picking it up when nobody else wanted gold assets, we were able to pick it up at a price that made a whole lot of sense. And most importantly, we were able to advance it privately. We raised some $22 million privately to advance the project back towards production so that now shareholders entering K92 don't have to go through that whole process because of the fact we've worked on it for the past 12 to 18 months on site, refurbishing and enhancing the already existing infrastructure. And this is infrastructure, existing mill, existing underground mine, 350-man camp, hydroelectric power right to the site, paved road right to the site, a short distance to a seaport. This had existing infrastructure, and we were able to go in, enhance it, refurbish it, upgrade it, and now production is imminent. And the reason Barrick paid big dollars for this project, remember, Barrick was the world's largest gold mining company when they bought this, is they saw that size potential and the very unique high-grade environment that this is in. And a real interesting anecdote that I often bring up when talking about the Barrick divestiture is it was just days after we acquired the project from Barrick that a fellow named Alex Davidson joined K92. Why is that important? It's because Alex was the executive vice president of Barrick Gold, in charge of exploration and corporate development worldwide when Barrick paid $141 million for this asset and when they subsequently invested in it. And that, I think, speaks volumes about Barrick's opinion of the project on a technical basis. Mm. Now, we don't take it for granted, Kenneth. Our timing was, for lack of a better word, lucky. We bought it when nobody else wanted gold assets. We had a team that was able to attract capital because of our track record. And now, investors have a situation where we have near-term production planned and substantial work in terms of expansion and growth plan over the coming weeks.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it is amazing, you know, purchasing that value in the trenches of the bear market and then IPOing not that long ago, a matter of a few weeks, a month ago or so, and, you know, into the bull market uptrend in gold. I mean, the situation for investors could not be any more ideal. And, you know, I want to ask you about the situation. You guys are on the verge of being a mid-tier gold producer and having a cash cost targeted close to $600 per ounce. And at $1,300 gold, that's a significant profit, especially if you think gold's going to 5,000, 6,000, who knows where. You know, what can investors look forward to here over the coming months?
You know, Kenneth, I'm always... because the mining business has inherent risks in it. It has commodity risk, it has mining risk, etc. I always urge people to be cautious. But what I will tell you as to this project is that some of the biggest risks in the industry have to do with construction risk, CapEx, building a mine, building a mill. And it, because of Barrick's substantial investment here, we've eliminated a lot of those risks. We're restarting a mine and a mill. We've refurbished a mine and a mill. We're not building it from scratch. And that's a big, big advantage, having a turnkey or close to turnkey type situation like we were able to put together. As far as our growth plan, originally we set out to restart the Irma Fimpa deposit, restart production there, use the existing processing facility, and that's what we're on the verge of doing. Then we want to grow from that production level at Irma Fimpa by targeting expansion and potential production at a deposit called Cora, which is only 600 meters away. And that's where I think we can provide people with visibility as to the fact that we're a startup producer and producing at Irma Fimpa. We then move to Cora, increase production rate, etc. This is the business plan we've laid out. There are all sorts of risks in the mining business, and I don't want to make it sound simple. I urge people to do their own due diligence, but what I'll tell you after being in the industry for essentially my whole career is that this is very unique to have a startup situation that has visibility over the next few years to legitimately target a move into that mid-tier type status. And with that, we've been able to attract a great team of guys on the ground with a track record in these restarts. I mentioned Alex Davidson's name, Alex being part of the K92 team. Another guy I have to mention is Doug Kerwin. Doug was the executive vice president of exploration for Ivanhoe when they made the OU Tolgoi discovery. And Doug, being part of the K92 team here, along with Alex, speaks volumes as to the technical merits of the project. And then Ian Stalker, who I've mentioned, and a fellow named John Lewins, who's the chief operating officer, just have wonderful track records of success at these restarts. And with that, shareholders not only get an asset that was a Barrick asset, but they also get a team that has consistently, over the past 30 years, established themselves as true mine builders. This time, they don't need to build the mine from scratch. They have to restart something that was already there.
Yeah, that's a powerful thing you're describing there, Bryan. Bryan, let's get back to talking about gold. And I want to talk about this shift from Western powers to Eastern powers. And, you know, we know that central banks like to discount gold here in the 21st century. Bernanke's calling it a tradition. Western central banks are depleting their reserves, and many question whether or not there is any gold at Fort Knox, just because, you know, we've depleted ourselves. You know, how important is gold to you going forward, despite central banking here in 2016? I mean, how important is gold going to be to money going forward in our financial situation?
Well, I think that it's extremely important, and I think that the central bankers all across the world conveniently dismissing gold as a relic, as something that's outdated. Look, gold lasted as a store of value and true wealth and a support for economic systems for 5,000 years, and just because some smart central bankers in the last 25 to 50 years believe something has changed, I don't give much credence to that. Now, at the same time, you have central bankers trying to defend their positions, and their positions, you know, have been positions of liquidation in recent memory, and they will say things like that to discredit gold. But you know who's smarter than that? It seems like China, it seems like Russia, it seems like some of our past sworn enemies in the West have somehow got this figured out and are gobbling up all the gold that they can get. As a Canadian, I was very embarrassed not too long ago to hear the announcement from Ottawa that Canada had liquidated all of its gold holdings.
Mm-hmm.
No gold left in Canada. And what did our esteemed central banker say? He said, don't worry, the Canadian currency is stable, it's fine. We don't need gold to represent a store of value because of the fact we hold over $50 billion in U.S. currency. Well, to me, one fiat currency, one piece of paper supporting another piece of paper, supporting another piece of paper, it doesn't give me a whole lot of confidence. And I think that somehow in the West, we just have missed the boat here. I think that places like China and Russia are gobbling up whatever gold they can get their hands on. But I think that there are enough smart voices in the wilderness here, in the U.S., in Canada, that are starting to see that this just doesn't make sense. And as a result of that, I think that you're starting to see a gradual re-entry or entry into precious metals. You're seeing it through the purchase, unfortunately, of paper precious metals. Mm. But you're also starting to see real interest and understanding that physical gold, physical silver, is an important part of a portfolio. And in the past, in any gold bull market of real substance, gold equities have outperformed bullion itself. So companies that have real gold, physical gold, that they can produce and sell into the market in a rising gold environment can be extremely powerful growth mechanisms within a portfolio. If you have a good gold asset that's producing at a time that you also have rising gold prices, it's incredibly powerful. And also, in addition to acting as a hedge against this global instability / insanity, also can provide a real growth opportunity for investors. Mm.
You know, that's great advice there, Bryan. In conclusion, if you have any more words, just to conclude your thoughts there and how people can proceed here in 2016 dealing with this current financial mess and, of course, being able to partner with you and K92, please share your thoughts.
Sure. And K92 is a unique situation in that we have a high-grade gold asset. But the reason that I call it unique is that, unlike a lot of comparables, we also have a means to process that asset because of the existing mill infrastructure that we purchased from Barrick. The underground development is done, so we can access that asset to get it through the processing facility. And we've got a team with a track record of doing so successfully over many decades in many different parts of the world. As far as overall portfolio management goes, I always urge people to be cautious, be prudent, think things through before making big moves. But at this time of global instability, I challenge people to really look through the holdings that they have, the asset allocations that they've made, and determine whether or not they have a good enough mix of paper assets, of real estate assets, of precious metals assets. Is there a balance there? And if things do go horribly wrong, are they going to have enough of a hedge that they ride out the instability on the other side? And with that, I just think that everybody has to look at and consider with their advisors, with their family, whether or not gold can be an important part of hedge against what looks to be a real tinderbox of an economic situation that really could be unprecedented in our lifetimes. It could make 2008 look like a walk in the park. Mm. So with that, I just urge people to really take a look at precious metals as a hedge. And I think that advice from Russ Kustrich at BlackRock, who's the head of asset allocation, and says gold's poised to go much higher and that very few hedges work as reliably as gold, I think that's good advice. And with that, investors should be cautious but should really consider gold as an asset class.
Bryan Slusarchuk, the president of K92 Mining. Bryan, thanks for coming on the show and sharing your words of wisdom with us in these very, very interesting times.
Great. Thanks a lot for having me, Kenneth.